Hello, I'm Graham. Hope everyone's having a great day. Welcome to today's video. Now, if you are a subscriber to my photographic blog, and I'll put a link to that in the video description below, so if you're not, you can actually join. I put an article in there about using your smartphone as a light meter. Now, that's created quite a bit of interest, so that's the reason that I'm producing this video today. Now, a lot of the questions were regarding the actual use of the apps themselves, and I'll run through those in a moment. But the other ones were regarding why should you use a handheld meter when the camera provides its own inbuilt metering for you. Well, a little bit of history. I came up through the film era, and in the film era, obviously you didn't have the facility of a camera bank to view your exposures. So nowadays we chimp the exposure, make sure we've got it looking right. In film days, you had to wait until the film was processed to be able to see whether you've got the correct exposure or not. So hence the resurgence of light meters to get the exposure correct. Now, film hasn't got a linear characteristic the same that a sensor in a modern digital camera has. The Hertzsprung-Dreyfield HD curve of a film has a traditional toe, linear portion in the middle, and then a shoulder for the highlights. It was important to get the normal exposure right in the center of that linear portion. If you were down towards the toe of the curve, you run into reciprocity. So a change of twice the amount of light didn't give you a corresponding change in the density of the film. So you had to use longer and longer exposures the more you went down that toe of the curve. With the modern digital sensor, we don't have this reciprocity failure because of the shape of the curve. The curve in the digital sensor is almost straight line. So the only problem we've got is the amount of dynamic range that the sensor will capture. Now, these will capture in the order of 9 to something like 13 or 14 f-stop difference between highlights and shadows. Because of this dynamic range restriction, it's important that we try to centralize our exposure in the middle of the exposure range, so that anything that's mid-tone gray, which would have a digital value of 127 when we look at a JPEG, it's important that that is at the center point of that exposure range. Because of this restricted dynamic range of, say, at the most 10 f-stops, if we want to capture the most dynamic range for highlights and shadows, we want our central exposure to be at the 5 f-stop range in the middle of the exposure. So it gives us 5 stops of underexposure and 5 stops of overexposure latitude. If our exposure is biased towards the highlights, then we run into highlight clipping. We can't record all the brightness of the scene. Similarly, if we are underexposing, we see a lot more highlight detail, but the shadows become blocked, so we can't see all the definition in the shadows. That's why these cameras offer a HDR mode. So the camera will take an exposure on the underexposed side and one at the middle and one at the overexposed, and merge those together to give you the expanded dynamic range. So it's important with our digital camera, we try to get the exposure right in the center of the exposure range. And that's where the light meter will come in. As we know, the exposure meter in the camera can be fooled by certain lighting conditions. So, for example, if you're taking a subject on snow, the camera will easily underexpose because it tries to make the snow neutral grey. So it shortens the exposure to make that white grey, which means your subject becomes underexposed as well. In that sort of situation, we use positive exposure value compensation to lengthen the shutter speed to capture the white as white. So we need a method by which we can meter the light, which is irrespective of the subject quality or the lighting quality. And that's where an incident light meter, such as this Iconic 478, comes into play. This meters the incident light, that's the amount of light falling on the subject, and converts that into an exposure for us. With our camera, we're using a reflected light meter. So that gives us a problem, that it is looking at the scene rather than the illumination. So we need a method to convert in the reflected light into incident light, and I'm going to show you how to do that in this video. Now, I'm actually filming this sequence with the Canon EOS M3, and I know with this lighting setup I need ISO 320 to give me enough light to give me the adequate shutter speed and aperture for this particular exposure. So if I was to take an incident light meter reading using this Iconic 478, it will give me the aperture if I set the ISO and the shutter speed, which are fixed values for the camera. So I need ISO 320 and I need a 60th of a second. So this device will calculate the f-stop using the exposure triangle. So I've set the ISO to be 320 and I've set the shutter speed to be 1/60th. So I'll now meter the scene and I point the meter towards the camera. So it's taking in 220 degrees worth of light to capture the exposure. And I can see on the screen it's f5.6 and 0.2 of a stop. So as near as we are saying f5.6, 1/60th of a second at ISO 320. And incidentally, the light meter is saying I'm recording this scene with 1,800 lux. Now, if you're in the States, you'd probably use foot candles and you can actually set this meter to read foot candles or lux. So that's the amount of light that's been recording this scene with now. So that's 1,800 lux. F5.6, 1/60th of a second at ISO 320. So hopefully that is going to be the value we'll get when we use the smartphone. Now, it doesn't matter whether you're using an iOS device or using an Android device, you'll find an app in the respective App Store or the Play Store to give you that facility. Now, the app that I've got on the smartphone is the Pocket Light Meter, and I'll put a link to that in the video description so you can download it if you've got an iOS device. Here it's running on my iPhone 5S, but it will run on any iOS device from your iPad to your iPod Touch. In fact, I've got it on my iPod Touch version 4 and it works fine. The advantage of the later cameras is you also get the color temperature reading as well. So it uses the exposure triangle rule as we discussed before. You dial in two components and it calculates the third. So I'm going to dial in ISO 320. I'm going to dial in the shutter speed, which I've got the camera set to, which is 1/60th of a second. And then I point the camera lens at this 18% reflectance card. Now this 18% grey card is part of a white balance set. You get a white, neutral grey and black. I prefer this A4 size. It gives me a more target area to work when using exposure. And I carry these in my backpack just about everywhere. So with that 18% reflectance grey card, it gives me the centre point of the exposure. So this meter should give me the correct f-stop dialed in with a shutter speed of 1/60th and ISO 320. So if I point the target at this 18% grey card, making sure that I'm not picking up the shadow caused by the phone on the light, and then press the hold button so I can actually read it. And the actual screen itself does say 1/60th of a second, f5.6 at ISO 320. So that is giving me the same illumination as that professional 478 meter from Siconic. So the actual method does work. Incidentally, if you do find that you're under or overexposing because the phone or tablet you're using isn't correctly calibrated, there is a bias operation in that app. So you can apply negative or positive exposure value compensation to get your exposures right. The way you would check that would be to photograph the grey card with your camera at that setting given by the meter. Then look at the grey card in your editing program and look at the digital value for the grey patch. If you find the value is 127, then it's correctly calibrated. If you find that you are below 127, so the camera is in fact underexposing, you need to put some positive meter exposure value compensation to correct the app to give you the correct exposure. Then you would reshoot the scene and check the value again in your editing program to make sure you're back to 127, and that means they've calibrated your particular meter with your grey card against the camera. With the Android device, I'll put a link to the app that I use. It's just called Light Meter, and this one actually supports incident and reflected light. The incident light meter is just using the front-facing camera, but it's very directional, so it depends on how you angle this to the light source as to the reading you get. So I don't recommend use the incident light meter reading with this particular app. Switch it to reflected mode and then repeat the process. So again, you can dial in the ISO. So in this case, it's going to be 320. So with ISO 320 locked into the meter, got this meter set to the reflected light meter mode. I can see in the central area of the app where I'm capturing the light from. Then I just press the measure button and the meter will respond and it will drive the scale to give you the correct alignment for the exposure. I can then look at the device and it's showing me Quite accurately, I've got 1/60th of a second at f5.6. So in this case, I know I've got my shutter speed set to 1/60th, so I just read off the aperture against that 1/60th, and it gives me f5.6. With this particular app, I haven't found a way of applying exposure value compensation. If the meter of the camera isn't giving you the correct exposure, you would have to apply an ISO change equal to what you find is the difference. So those are the two applications that run on iOS and Android, and the method you've got there for converting your reflected light meter reading into an incident light meter reading. You could, of course, use the metering circuit in the camera to achieve the same results. Just point the meter of the camera, probably put it in its spot metering mode, read the value from the grey card, and then set those in as manual values in your manual exposure. I use that quite often if I'm out photographing flowers, particularly white flowers. I'll place the grey card at the subject, use the camera to measure the exposure, and then set those in as manual values. I can then take multiple exposures, and there's no change in exposure between each of the shots, so I get a good consistent exposure series. One of the advantages of the later iOS app, particularly with the later cameras, is the facility this app gives you of reading the color temperature. So if I just point the target square again at the target, it's showing me that my color temperature is 5151K. Now, the LED light sources I'm using for recording this video at the moment are daylight rated 5400 Kelvin with a 96 CRI according to the manufacturer. So there's a 4% difference between the red, the green and the blue as a maximum difference. So at 5,400, we're seeing just under 5,200. They're pretty close to the actual daylight temperature. But before I started the video, I did a manual white balance using the Canon EOS white balance setup to record the grey card and then set the white balance on that. And you're probably familiar with setting the manual white balance on your camera. As a way of illustrating the way that the camera is easily fooled, because I've got this camera set up now in the manual mode, if I was to go and use the light meter built into the EOS M3 and try to meter this scene, you'll probably find that this scene will go very much overexposed because it tries to make the black background into neutral grey. So I'll just nip behind the camera and set the exposure to what the camera thinks should be a normal exposure for this scene. So I've just set up the camera to what it thinks is the correct exposure, taking into consideration the black background. You can see that the image is overexposed. I'll just nip back behind the camera and set it back to 1/60th at f5.6 and ISO 320. So that's the exposure back to where the light meter tells me the correct exposure for this situation would be. Well, that's it for the video. Thanks very much for watching. And incidentally, if you are not a subscriber to my photographic blog, if there are places available on the subscription list, please do subscribe. You'll then get your fortnightly newsletter. Have a look at the blog. There's lots more articles on the FZ range of cameras from Panasonic. And I've just started some of the Micro Four Thirds and Canon FX series cameras there as well. So, if you're not already a subscriber to my channel, please do click the subscribe button and then you'll be notified in your subscription list when I've uploaded new videos. So until the next one, please do take care and I'll see you then. Goodbye for now.